Hachette Audio presents SEAL Team 6, Hunt the Viper. Written by Don Mann and Ralph Pezzullo. Read by Peter Ganim. If a viper lives in your room and you wish to have a peaceful sleep, you must first chase it out. Gautama Buddha. Dedicated to the men and women who risk their lives in the global fight against oppression and evil. Chapter 1. Live as if you were to die tomorrow. Learn as if you were to live forever. Mahatma Gandhi. The six heavily armed U.S. Navy SEALs watched the battered pickup approach on Highway 47 in Iraqi Kurdistan as rockets, artillery shells, and mortars exploded in the distance. Team leader Tom Crocker had a lot on his mind today. The fierce fighting to dislodge ISIS, Islamic State of Iraq and Syria, from nearby Mosul. The mental welfare of one of his men, who had just learned that his father had gone missing, and his own future. As he stood along the two-lane asphalt road, his H&K 416 automatic rifle pressed against his right bicep, using his left hand to shield his eyes from the dust that swept up from the gently undulating plain, an alert came over the radio. A French AS-532 Cougar helicopter had crashed south of the town of Sinjar, approximately 50 clicks or kilometers from the Syrian border. Other concerns quickly vanished from his head. "Survivors?" he asked into the mic clipped to the top of his camos as he waved the pickup to the side of the road. Davis, the team's comms man, seated in the second Flyer 60 advanced light strike vehicle, answered, "CC, Coalition Command, is reporting six aboard the Cougar, including pilot and company, several casualties. It came down in contested territory, so medevac can't land until the ground is cleared." Crocker's eyes never left the pickup, which slowed to stop, a sorry-looking bag of bolts if he'd ever seen one, with a front bumper held on with string, a mismatched colored hood, and a right windshield perforated with bullet holes. Another part of his mind remained focused on the downed French helo. "How far?" he asked into his mic. "How far what? How far is the Cougar from where we are now?" "Southwest, maybe 20 clicks," Davis answered. "Take us 15, 20 minutes to get there, depending on the roads, which are probably shit." Most of the land in this part of Iraqi Kurdistan was flat, with the exception of the Sinjar Mountains north. Fresh fields of wheat, cotton, and tobacco interrupted by primitive villages and dirt paths. So off-road travel was an option. So was the presence of mines and IEDs. "Tell CT to get on the saw and cover this pickup," Crocker barked into the mic as the vehicle rattled onto the shoulder and stopped. He was referring to the gas-operated squad automatic weapon, SAW, that sat in the bed of the Flyer 60, a light machine gun with a rapid rate of fire of 200 rounds per minute and effective range of 800 meters, which had been a mainstay of the U.S. Armed Forces since the 1980s. The six men, Crocker, Ackle, Mancini, Davis, Rip, and CT, were members of Black Cell, a special unit of SEAL Team 6, DEVGRU. African-American, 6'2", and ripped, CT was a former T6 Red Squad member, and before that, an NCAA Division II wrestling champion and martial arts specialist who had grown up in Compton, California. He'd left, he joked, because he got tired of being shot at without combat pay. He'd recently joined Black Cell and was training to replace Davis as the team's comms chief, as Davis was planning to transfer to an intel job at ST-6's base in Dam Neck Naval Base at the end of the month. Said he wanted to spend more time with his family and surf. Crocker would miss him. They'd survived all kinds of catastrophes together. Helicopter crashes, enemy attacks, captivity, even an avalanche. Now his right-hand man Mancini, a.k.a. Manny, or by his radio alias Big Wolf, pointed his MP7A1 submachine gun at the driver and used his left hand to indicate to the occupants of the pickup to get out. "Refugees," he said sympathetically as a squat woman with a long burgundy scarf tied over her head kicked open the passenger door and the door slid off its hinges and crashed to the ground.
"Nice ride," Ekel commented.
"At least they made it out," Crocker said. The SEALs had stopped dozens of similar vehicles so far, 6 weeks into their deployment in Kurdistan. Untold thousands of other Syrian refugees hadn't gotten safely out. Instead, they'd been robbed, raped, and murdered and hung from lampposts and trees by Syrian armed forces, gangsters, or one of the myriad armed opposition groups to the regime of Syrian President Bashar Assad. Around 10 million of them had fled that country since the start of the civil war in 2012, creating a human rights disaster of epic proportions. Crocker had seen the teeming, sprawling refugee camps in Jordan and Turkey, and the kids playing in dust-filled alleys between prefabricated pods that served as temporary shelters. Heartbreaking and hopeful at the same time. Kids in the most difficult situations found ways to amuse themselves.
"Let's get this over quick and go help the cougar," Crocker growled.
He'd grown to loathe Syrian President Assad for committing genocide on his own people and couldn't fathom why the rest of the world had watched this catastrophe unfold for years without doing anything to stop it. Out of the cab of the truck stepped a middle-aged woman, two teenage boys, and a 5-year-old girl clutching an unclothed plastic doll. They all shared the same thick, dark, crescent-shaped eyebrows and looked like they'd slept in their clothes. The teenagers stood behind the woman, who Crocker assumed was a relative, with their hands in the pockets of their jeans. Crocker said to Akil,
"Tell the boys we need to see their hands."
The team's operational terp, Zumar, was currently honeymooning with his bride in Beirut, Lebanon, on the Mediterranean coast, so they were relying on their teammate Akil, an Egyptian-American SEAL who spoke Arabic and some Farsi, which were the chief languages in this part of the world, along with various Kurdish dialects. Akil addressed the boys in Arabic, and they responded by bowing their heads and then holding their hands up for the SEALs to see. They appeared to be brothers. The older of the two had a few wisps of beard and a fresh, jagged scar on his head and trembled from head to toe.
"What happened to him?" Crocker asked.
Ackle spoke to the woman, and as she answered, she waved her arms dramatically and contorted her face, indicating objects falling from the sky and something landing on their heads. Her voice shook with emotion until it broke, and she started weeping and sunk to her knees. Crocker pulled her up. He didn't need to hear the translation from Akil to know the story. He saw the pain in her eyes, and for a second, felt the buzz of her desperation reach into his chest. Akil relayed the details. They were Christians and had been hiding in the suburbs of Aleppo. Her husband had once been a bus driver. They were living in a garage when it was bombed, killing her husband and burying her son. Rescue workers dug the boy out, but he hadn't been the same. They'd sold practically everything they had to buy the truck. Militiamen and roving gangs had stolen most of what was left, and they hadn't eaten in days. All this was communicated while CT kept watch with the saw, and Mancini and Rip inspected plastic bags, which were piled in the pickup bed.
"Household stuff and clothing," Mancini reported. "All right, let's get them some MREs and bottles of water and send them on their way. Alert Colonel Rastan's men that they're coming. Hopefully they can find some cots in the Red Cross camp outside Erbil."
Colonel Rastan was the commander of a ragtag but hard-fighting company of Peshmerga soldiers who were trying to wrest this part of their native Kurdistan from ISIS control. Erbil was the sleek, modern capital of Kurdistan, where oil deals were negotiated by French, British, and U.S. executives, luxuriating in brand-new 5-star hotels and entertained by Russian and Uzbek hookers.
The refugee mom hugged Crocker and muttered some sort of prayer of thanks as Rip, Mancini, and Akil set armfuls of bottled water and MREs into the back of the pickup. "Safe travels," he said, as his teammates helped the family back into the truck and lifted the passenger door in place. The wind picked up, sending a piece of brown paper twisting east toward twin trails of garbage and waste that paralleled the highway to the edge of the horizon. "Peace," one of the boys shouted out the pickup window as it passed.
"Peace," Crocker shouted.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.